Thomas Pereira asks, neither my mother nor myself respond to normal or even high doses of cytomel T3, up to 140 micrograms per day in divided doses with thermogenesis. Body temperatures remain low, reverse T3 is normal. Could you discuss the factors that may be interfering with heat production in response to T3 and offer considerations of how to improve this? Man, that's an awesome question, but I don't know if I have an answer to that. So clearly, having good levels of reverse T3 tells you is that it doesn't seem like the body is deliberately getting rid of the thyroid hormone. So reverse T3, I would consider that a sign that your body just like doesn't want the thyroid hormone around, and you're trying to manipulate the thyroid hormone, and your body is just saying like, no, I'm too stressed to carry this out. That doesn't seem to be happening. And so that makes me wonder if there could be a problem with taking up the thyroid into the cells, in which case I would expect thyroid hormone levels to be higher in the blood than you would otherwise expect them to be. Or if there's a problem with the thyroid actually carrying out its functions inside the cell to regulate gene expression. And a couple things that would pop up there would be that zinc is necessary to allow the thyroid receptor to bind to the DNA. In fact, zinc is necessary for everything that has a nuclear receptor that alters gene expression by something binding to a nuclear receptor. They're all zinc dependent. So the receptors for vitamin A and vitamin D, the receptors for the sex hormones, for thyroid hormone, all require zinc to act. So if you're zinc deficient, that could be possible. But I would expect, I mean, you seem to be saying that it's a specific thermogenesis response. And so that makes me ask, is it only are you seeing every other thing that you would expect from thyroid hormone and not thermogenesis? If that's the case, I have no idea. But if you're not seeing any of the effects from thyroid hormone that you would expect, then I would say maybe some kind of resistance not getting to the cell if the blood levels are higher than you would expect them to be, or if the blood levels are normal, maybe not acting on the nuclear receptor. I would think zinc deficiency, also high levels of free fatty acids. Thomas is raising his hand. Let me call on Thomas. This is the first time I've done this. So, Thomas, you're allowed to talk. Do you want to come on screen too, or just talk?
Hi, Chris. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Wow.
Audio good, or do you want video, Tim?
If you want to do the video, I can do that. Let's see. Do you call on me again to do the video, or do I press something?
No, I think you are. I think you if your video's on, you should be able to. I should be able to see you now. I can't. Anyway, okay, let's just go forward with the question. So,
I just wanted to add that the only response that I do get to the thyroid hormone is increase in heart rate. And as far as thermogenesis, absolutely nothing at all. And taking super physiological doses as well.
What do the blood levels look like? Do they look normal or do they look high?
Since I started with experimenting with very high doses, I haven't had my blood levels checked, but I would guess that they're very high. I've heard of some other people taking very high doses and their T3 levels in the blood test go to levels that are even undetectable by the normal screening.
Yeah, my suspicion is that someone knows the answer to this, and I just don't have the knowledge around thyroid hormones to answer it. Thyroid is an interesting subject for me, but it hasn't been what I've been digging into the most in the last few years. So I do think that it's possible that there could be resistance from elevated free fatty acids or from...
I do have type 1 diabetes, and I think that high free fatty acids is typical in type 1 diabetes.
Oh, okay. I missed that for context. So I know, I definitely can't answer that question at the level of what is what is the reason why you do respond with heart rate and don't respond with heat and other things. I can't answer it at that level, but I can say that I would expect type 1 diabetes and perhaps other aspects of type 1 diabetes, but certainly the elevation of free fatty acids, I would expect that to cause a level of thyroid hormone resistance on the basis of animal experiments and cellular experiments showing that free fatty acids inhibit the binding of thyroid hormone to its nuclear receptor. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what to do with that except suppress the free fatty acids. I mean, if you're on insulin therapy, how are you managing your type 1 diabetes?
I'm eating moderate to high carb, moderate protein and lowish fat diet. I take aspirin, niacinamide to deal with free fatty acids. And I treat with sufficient insulin to keep myself at fairly good levels. I have fairly good control. Especially.
Well, I don't know. I don't know what else you could do with the exception of measure the free fatty acids. And if they are elevated, I mean, they might not be if you're taking insulin and you're eating moderate to high carb, I don't know how elevated they are. But additional anti-lipolytic mechanisms like exogenous ketones, I mean, that's probably... That's probably a bad idea. I don't know. I would start with like maybe see if you can get free fatty acids measured, which would often be called NEFA, NEFA for non-esterified fatty acids.
I did have them measured early on in my diagnosis and before I was on actually sufficient insulin, and they were in range, but at the topper level of the range, but nothing that seemed extreme, but I don't know if even in the high range, that could be problematic.
I don't know either, because the amount of evidence that we have is A, it's from animals, and B, it's only a couple studies, and C, it really isn't that clear about what the concentration is needed, because where it's happening is at the level of the nuclear receptor, and you don't necessarily have the blood concentrations exactly reflecting what's actually making it into those compartments of the cell. So it's kind of going off on a limb saying that reducing free fatty acids might be the thing that helps. It's pretty speculative, and obviously you have to be super careful with that, because anything you do to suppress lipolysis or get more carbohydrate in or take, you know, all of that could affect your insulin requirement and so on. But the only other thing I can think of off the top of my head is to look at your plasma zinc. Have you done that?
I have not. That's definitely something.
I take a look at that because zinc is needed for the needed for all the nuclear receptors to bind to the DNA, and thyroid hormone is one of the things that impacts.
Mm-hmm. And so just to finish up real quick, I just want to ask a philosophical question.
Sure.
What is the most important thing, to maintain your body temperature at a good level or to ensure that your temperature is being generated through your metabolism? Because I do notice that if I do keep my temperature up with clothing and heaters, I have better cognitive function, but I don't.
Yeah. Well, that's a really interesting question. I think that they are both important. So like one of the reasons that you maintain a certain body temperature is because it makes all your enzymes work at the way they're supposed to, right? So your metabolism gets seriously messed up if your core body temperature is not what it's supposed to be. Sometimes it's supposed to go up, sometimes it's supposed to go down. So when you have a fever, it goes up because you're deliberately trying to impact processes that work at a higher rate when you have higher temperature. When you go to sleep, you're trying to pull it down because the processes that you're trying to engage in are optimized at that body temperature. And so to some degree, if you can modify that with clothing, it makes tremendous sense. I mean, as sort of proof of like intuitive proof of principle, look at someone who can't fall asleep if they're wearing pajamas and heavy blankets and can sleep fine if they're in boxer shorts and just have a sheet on them, right? Because it didn't matter that, like, you could have lowered your core body temperature by taking 3 to 6 grams of glycine, but you fell asleep because you took the sheets off and you took the PJs off, right? So, you know, it's both, but it's absolutely the case that if you feel better cognitive function when you have more clothes on to compensate for lower body temperature, that absolutely makes physiological sense that you would want to do that. I mean, you can't have everything. I would rather your pancreas just start making all the insulin it needs, but nice. Your options are limited, right? So I don't know if you can fix the temperature issue. If you can with fixing it at the root problem, great. But if you can't, then absolutely I would manage your temperature with clothing, especially if you're, I mean, you're telling me that you got the payoff. So I think that's a clear win.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. That was very helpful.